This is DJ the Prodigy Pen, and you're listening to the Ringside Report.
Hey, this is Kane Velasquez, and you're listening to Ringside Report Radio.
This is Chuck Liddell, and you're listening to the Ringside Report.
Hi, he's Wanderlei, the ex-murder Silver, and you're listening to Ringside Report Radio.
This is Tito Ortiz, the People's Champ, and you're listening to Ringside Report Radio.
This is Uriah Faber, the California Kid, and you're listening to the Ringside Report.
This is Randy, the Natural Couture, and you're listening to the Ringside Report.
Hi, this is Vito Belfer, and you're listening to Ringside Report Radio.
This is Chael Sonnen, and you are listening to Ringside Report Radio.
This is Jacques Favier, and welcome to Ringside Report Radio.
Hope you're ready for the next episode.
All right, we are live. Welcome to Ringside Report Radio. I am Dave Simon. AJ D'Alessio is here. Freddie is here. At Freddie MMA on Twitter. At Danny Bruck on Twitter for AJ. You can follow me at Dave Simon MMA. RingsideReport.net is our website. And, of course, we start the show with some technical issues. We got our man Jimmy G in the house. Jimmy the Genius, let's clap it up for Jimmy G. Oh, yeah, Jimmy's here.
Love, man. It's all about love.
Yeah, Jimmy is here.
We got a producer.
Yeah, we have a producer here tonight. Jimmy's not being paid for this extra hour of work, although he may bill the company. Who knows what Jimmy might do.
Free coffee.
Let's get
him a coffee.
You get the free coffee anyways, AJ. Don't give Jimmy coffee.
I drank it. I got a
cold.
Sorry, Jim.
Jimmy's trying to take your coffee. So what happened was, as soon as we were about to start the show, Jimmy did something, screwed up the whole like computer system here on the radio station. So Jimmy's here until he fixes it. That's the deal, Jimmy?
Yes.
That is the way it works on a Saturday morning.
It's Friday night, Jimmy. Turn your mic off. Turn your mic off. I don't want to hear you. See, usually I'm behind the board and I can press all the buttons and I have control of everything. I can turn AJ's mic off. I can adjust the settings. So if we sound a little bit weird tonight, it's Jimmy's fault. So thanks, Jimmy, for hanging around and fixing the problems here.
So that means I got free reign tonight.
Yeah,
see, yes, Jimmy, I love you.
Yeah, see, Fred, now we're in trouble. And not only that, but a programming note, I'm going to be in trouble for the next 2 weeks, right, Fred?
Yeah, because I'm going to be off for 2 weeks, so you're going to be alone with Anthony.
What? What's up?
But you know what? Just back to Jimmy, I think poor guy, he wanted to leave early, and he's stuck here right now, so unfortunately for him.
And I was letting him have it, too. Yeah. I was not happy with Jimmy before the
show. I thought it was going to turn into a wrestling match there.
Yeah, it was going to get bad, you know, because we're about to start the show, and things start turning badly. And it's weird, because Jimmy's not usually here before us on a Friday night, right? It's our boy Marco. Not Muscles Marco, but Marco Polo. And things always seem to go smoothly when he's here. And all of a sudden, Jimmy's here and everything malfunctions. So I'm suspicious is all I'm saying. Suspicious.
We got to send Jimmy the love, man.
Yeah.
Jimmy looks like
always
a good
love
guy.
For Jimmy.
You know?
I'll hook you up for Starcade or something on
his
Sunday,
His car is still
Jimmy,
warming
okay?
up, you know? So, like...
Yeah, his car... Yeah, if you want to steal Jimmy's car, what kind of car do you drive, Jimmy? Are the keys in the ignition?
It's a Lamborghini.
Yeah, right.
Testarossa.
Yeah, okay.
2014.
Turn your mic off. Turn your mic off. Again, I don't want to hear you. I wish I had more control over Jimmy's mic so I could just cut it. Ah, oh, boy. All right. We got MMA to get to here, gentlemen. Chuck Liddell and Tito Ortiz are fighting tomorrow night for some reason. Curtis Blaydes and Francis Ngannou are fighting tomorrow morning for some reason. Like, what is this confusion in MMA? Chuck Liddell and Tito Ortiz aren't supposed to be fighting anymore. And I want to see Francis Ngannou fight at night. Why is he fighting at 6:30 in the morning?
What?
Well, it's because it's... Yeah, AJ doesn't even know. See how prepared AJ is for the show here, Fred? He doesn't even know why or when. But the fight is tomorrow in Beijing, China.
It's because you got me off the game there with Jimmy. That's
I know. He's got us all off our game right now. But yeah, the fights are in China tomorrow morning.
Beijing.
Main card starts at 6:30 a.m. That's not the prelims. The prelims on Fight Pass... start like a couple hours after we're done. They start at 3:15, I think.
So they just stay up and watch it.
Sure.
Sure, you do that.
You do that. You stay up until, you know, whatever, 9 a.m.
I mean, you don't
you can
want
to stay up all night.
I forgot
you
guys
don't
have
want
kids.
You don't want to miss Wu Yanan against Lauren Mueller or
Who?
Wu Yao Zong against Rashad Coulter. I mean, please, don't miss those fights.
I seem to be noticing a trend with the names there. It's like Chinese name and American name, right? Is that the gist of the card?
Zhang Weili against Jessica Aguilar?
Oh, okay. Maybe Brazilian? I don't know. But, no, she's probably American, right? So it's like China versus the world? That's the card tomorrow night? Tomorrow morning or in a few hours? Or how we...
Yes and no. Yes and no.
Some of these fights don't have Chinese...
Yeah, like Curtis Blades against Francis Ngannou.
Yeah, but that's the main event. But I'm saying the rest of the card, the prelim deal...
Even on the prelim. Like, I mean... There's people from all over the world. It's a UFC card, but yeah, it does have a little bit of a local Chinese flavor.
Well, you got the...
Which is the deal, you know, when they go to any kind of market.
When they come to Canada, there's a Canadian flavor.
Yeah, that's it.
Sure, but you still have Li Jialing that's still fighting. I mean, at least he's on there.
Okay.
Oh, yeah? And why
is he... Well, he's exciting.
Okay.
It doesn't surprise me that he's on there. He's one of the more exciting, more known fighters in China.
He's one of the... You know, only known fighters from China, right?
Except for Song Yadong, who's...
Who?
Song Yadong.
Is he Chinese, though?
Song, actually...
Yes.
Well, it's Korean name. Song is a Korean name, but I think the Yadong part is Chinese. I think he's Chinese.
Wikipedia tells me he's Chinese.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he's the... Yeah,
but
the
he's
biggest
not,
prospect
oh,
right
he
now
is fighting on this card. Song Yadong.
Against Vince Morales.
20 years old, this guy. 13-3. Hell of a name, too. Song... First name Song, like singing a song. Last name Yadong. Yadong.
Yadong.
Yadong.
You like the dong?
That's what she said. She said, yeah, dong.
Jimmy, you like that?
Jimmy loved it.
You don't get that on any other show.
Jimmy doesn't understand that reference. It's okay. Thanks, Jimmy. Francis Ngannou, Curtis Blades is in the main event. What do you guys think, man? Do you think Ngannou bounces back here? Like... Curtis Blades is tough, right? And these two guys fought before. It was the only loss in Blades' career. He's 10-1.
But it was a stoppage, right?
It was due to a cut.
Right.
He lost by TKO, but it was a doctor stoppage. So it's not like he got knocked out. It's not like he got submitted by Ngannou. He just got beat up so bad that the doctor was like, look at your face, man. You should stop fighting. And then he did. But since then, he's had a lot of success. He's on a 5-fight win streak, really, with a no contest in there, but he beat Alexei Oleinik, Daniel Malanchuk, Mark Hunt, and Alistair Overeem all in a row, and those are quality opponents, quality victories. He's on a serious run, and if he wins this fight here against Francis Ngannou, he's going to be in the mix for a heavyweight title shot, even though the heavyweight division right now is kind of confusing. I don't know who's in line for a title shot. I don't know if it really matters right now. I think the next two guys, like the guys that are going to fight for the heavyweight title next, probably won't fight the number one contender in their next fight if they have a next fight. Like, I think Daniel Cormier is probably going to fight Brock Lesnar, and Daniel Cormier is going to retire after fighting Brock, win or lose. Probably win, I'm guessing. And Brock Lesnar will probably have this one fight, and I don't imagine he's going to keep fighting after this. So even if Curtis Blades or Ngannou win, like, yeah, they might get a title shot, but the champion might not be Brock or DC.
You know what? I'm still, like, I know this week there's been talk that, yeah, there's supposedly nothing that could stop Brock from fighting in the UFC.
The talk was from Paul Heyman,
yeah,
who's
exactly.
his wrestling manager.
Yeah, exactly. He's, so
I saw a post that said, hey, Brock's manager says nothing would stop him from fighting in whatever. And I was like, wait a second.
That's Paul Heyman.
He's not Brock's manager. He plays Brock's manager on TV. That would be like quoting Baron Corbin, the general manager on Raw, about ratings for the Monday Night Raw show, saying general manager of Raw, Baron Corbin. He doesn't run anything on Raw. He's just a figurehead. He's playing. Paul Heyman is a performer performing the role of Brock's manager on TV. So let's not get confused.
But he must have some pull.
No, he doesn't. He doesn't negotiate Brock's contracts. He's Brock's friend. He's Brock's partner on TV, but that's where it ends. Let's not get confused. Paul Heyman does not negotiate Brock's UFC contracts.
Because I was reading something like a couple of days back, and it was like, Paul Heyman says that he's going to represent like McGregor.
Yeah, see, this is why you need me here on a show like this. When I know the wrestling world and the MMA world in the same way, I need to explain the wrestling world sometimes to you, AJ. It's what they call a work.
Did Johnny tell you? I really got into it.
You say on stage shows how little you know about professional wrestling.
No, man, I went to support the fighter.
You mean in the ring.
Well, in the ring, exactly.
But you, what did you call it? A stage. It's not a stage. It's a ring. It's a squared circle.
The ring stage.
20 by 20 foot ring. Okay?
Well, you see, go back to my point. I'm not convinced that Daniel Cormier's next fight is going to be against Brock Lesnar. So, you know.
I think it probably will be.
Hopefully it is, but if I'm Daniel Cormier, I still think there's other possibilities out there. So the winner of this Blades and Ganou fight, who knows? Maybe it's in the discussion. Stipe's definitely in the discussion as a contender. So if you're Blades or Ngannou, this is a very important fight. Maybe the winner fights Stipe.
Yeah, well, what about Velasquez and his coming back? So
I don't know where he's going to land, though. I mean,
Cormier was saying,
I can see the title being vacant after DC's next fight.
And that's what I think is going to happen, because between Kane and Cormier, I mean, these guys train in the same camp. They're good friends. Yeah. And there's no way they're going to fight. What I think is that Cormier is going to have one last fight. It's either going to be against Lesnar, or it might be against Stipe again, just to end it. But he's going to pull back, and Velasquez is going to come, and he's going to fight Stipe at some point. And that's what I think. And who's going to beat him? Even Cormier said that Velasquez is a better fighter than him.
You're talking about Kane versus Stipe down the road?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a good fight. I don't know if it's going to materialize, but I would like to see it.
But Velasquez has to fight someone, right?
Sure.
I don't know.
A comeback fight, that's real tough for Kane.
Why? McGregor did it.
Yeah, and how did it go?
But it didn't. Yeah, exactly. It didn't go so well.
When's the last time Kane fought? Because I have the UFC rankings in front of me, and Kane's not even on them no more.
Really?
Yeah, they got a new page for the UFC ranking. Looks pretty nice, but I got Stipe, Derek Lewis.
Kane's last fight was July 2016, a TKO win over Travis Brown.
So, yeah,
and I think that was Travis Brown's last fight, too, right?
Yeah,
so they might have took Kane off the rankings completely, which kind of weird.
Well, when you're inactive for over 2 years, right? It's been over 2 years since he fought. So,
I mean,
what are you
going to
do?
George,
he was
right?
The best in the world at one point, but when you're not fighting and it's not clear, I mean, even Kane was talking about going to WWE. He went to the WWE Performance Center. Fred, your boy Seth Rollins is probably going to face Brock at WrestleMania. How do you like that?
Oh, that sounds nice.
See Fred rocking the Seth Rollins shirt right now.
Hey.
Very excited for your boy Seth.
Yeah. Nice.
Main reason, it's because I've been inactive for like a month and a half and put on some weight a little bit, so I have to get the large t-shirts and shirts out.
You can blame it on Dave's cookies that he keeps bringing here. That's
I don't
the
know
problem.
What you're talking about, AJ. No, stop spreading rumors.
Well, what? The cookies, ginger, man?
The ginger, right,
Dave, are you serious? That's a good one, man.
Where were you going with that, Dave?
That was a good one.
Well, I didn't know what he was
talking about. I finally
got
Dave. Thank you. Thank you. I love it. I finally got Dave.
My God.
Jimmy.
Jimmy, let me ask you something. You just played a sound effect, right?
Now, yes, I did.
Now, that channel that you had with the sound effect.
The system has been reset, everything is good.
That's not what I wanted to know. Were you that channel, was that on B? Was that recording too? Or not?
It was not.
Why? So
Jimmy just screwed
it?
Up our podcast is what I'm saying. There was a sound effect, but people that listen to the podcast won't hear it because Jimmy wasn't recording that sound effect.
Jimmy.
Because Jimmy is not that good.
Jimmy, I finally got a drum roll on this.
Yeah,
didn't hear the drum roll.
He got a little sound effect, but it's going to be only for the radio version of this program because Jimmy wasn't keeping that in B the way it needs to be.
I'll do it right now.
There we go.
Okay,
Ba-da-boom.
Now. Yeah, now.
Dave's eating gingerbread cookies.
Unbelievable. Thanks, Jimmy. So the system is fixed?
Yes, sir.
So you're going to leave now?
Why? Jimmy, stick around,
No,
man.
You have to stick around because we're not done. We still have things to do.
I mean, somebody's got to put the commercials later on.
Yeah, you want to throw us to break, Jimmy? Should we take a pause here, guys, so we could kind of reset and get rid of Jimmy?
Why? Poor Jimmy.
Well, he's got to go home, no?
Jimmy, stick around, man.
I have to come back at 6 a.m., exactly.
Just sleep here.
All right, Jimmy, get the hell out of here. It's been great seeing you. We love you, Jimmy. We're taking... What? No, we're going to break. Don't tell me when to go to break. It's my show. I tell you when to go to break, damn it. Jimmy, don't make me come over there.
Jimmy's a pretty big guy, too, eh? It's not like he's a small guy.
What's he going to do?
Jimmy.
What's he going to do?
Let's lay down the bets. Fred?
Jimmy, what do you... Jimmy thinks he could take me. Jimmy outweighs me by, like, what, 100 pounds at least?
50, 60? Not sure.
I would say at least 65 pounds.
Something of that nature.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see that.
You think you can take me?
Well, I said I have no idea until you actually get into the ring or on the mat.
Or on the stage. Like
stage.
I said, yeah.
Have you ever fought?
AJ, what do you think? AJ, you think Jimmy has a chance?
It's going to be hard, Jimmy.
Come on, man.
Well, everything's tough in life.
Yeah,
everything is tough.
You know what? I'm going to tell you something, Jimmy. I saw Dave with my own eyes. Wait,
Jimmy's got belief, man. Jimmy believes in himself.
Hey, listen, you
got
to believe, man. Like McGregor,
absolutely.
You got to believe.
I
saw Dave pick up Johnny North and lift him up. And Johnny North
and do a couple of squats.
The anniversary. It was on Twitter. I saw those pictures. Yes.
Wasn't that an awesome show?
It was a great show.
Thank you.
And a great picture, too.
There's a picture there of it.
Actually,
there you go. AJ's got a picture of it in the studio to commemorate the day I lifted Johnny North.
And that was pretty impressive, Dave.
That's
I thought you were
going
to get a hernia out of that, but you managed to get, like, yeah, that was impressive.
You want me to pick you up during the break?
I know you could pick me up.
Let's pick you up. All right, Jimmy, go to break. It's Ringside Report Radio. We're going to give you our picks for the Blades and Ganu fight, and we'll also give you our picks for Chuck and Tito and whatever else AJ has up his sleeve. When we come back, Ringside Report Radio, live on TSN 690. It is Ringside Report Radio. I'm Dave Simon. Fred Garcia here. AJ D'Alessio here. Jimmy's gone. We got rid of Jimmy. So that was good. That was good. He's not here anymore. AJ is filming me live on something.
Instagram?
Where's your mic now? I think Jimmy like disappeared your mic. Where are you, AJ?
Back on. Can you hear me?
There you are.
There we go.
So we're on the Ringside Report Instagram right now?
Yes, sir.
So you can follow the Ringside Report Instagram at Ringside Report to see what the show looks like while we're doing it live, as we're doing it live right now. Fred's got a cool Seth Rollins shirt. I've got a sweater on. AJ is behind the camera just with a grin on his face. Looks so happy. People should see that just dumb look on your face.
What are you talking about?
Yeah, you should film yourself.
Because I'm laughing at, like, you said, like, his Rollins shirt and all that. But
get back on, Mike. It's a radio show, AJ. I mean, come on,
sit down. You didn't mention the wrist injury there.
Yeah, Fred is hurt. Fred has had a wrist injury. We talked about it on the show. We also, did we mention, Fred, that you're going to be away for a couple weeks?
Yeah, we mentioned it a little bit. I'm leaving for 2 weeks. So.
AJ, did you hear that? So it's going to be me and you.
Are you doing that fishing trip again?
I don't know where. Fred, where are you going next week? Where are you
going
to be? Fred is going to be gone for the next 2 weeks.
Next week, it's like a Christmas office party. So
what, do you have to go away for 2 weeks for that?
No,
what kind of Christmas party
the week after that, I got some
his girlfriend's
plans.
Christmas office party, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And then the week after, what? You're not going to say where you're going?
Yeah, I'm going to be in Toronto for the UFC.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah? Excuse me.
Yeah, that's right. Big time over here.
Oh, yeah, you did
Fred.
Tell me about that.
Fred's going for a couple of weeks, so it's going to be you and me, AJ, for the next
awesome,
couple of weeks.
Man.
Which I think
I might
we,
call in from Toronto,
we,
depending.
You need to call in, and I think we need somebody here, a third man in the chair. Without Fred, we need somebody to kind of help me do the show with AJ.
Who do
not,
we get?
Not really help me do the show, just help me handle AJ.
Well, AJ, he might be at TKO on the Friday.
Oh, yeah, that's
so.
Right. That's true.
So,
good point.
So knowing him, be alone. He'll just bring somebody. He'll pick somebody in the crowd, start talking
bring Johnny
to them.
North. I think we need Johnny North on the show.
The makes homeless sense. Guy.
So Johnny North can finally, you know, talk about who he saw you with at his wrestling match last week.
Why don't we talk about Johnny's homelessness?
You mean the story that Johnny North told today on Dave and Johnny Live, which you can watch
best
right now?
Best show ever. Best show ever.
Thank you, AJ. You can watch it right now on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/ringsidereport.net.
I wonder what people want to hear about, Johnny being homeless or AJ's date. Because like
that Johnny North story was hilarious. Johnny North told a story today about him being mistaken for a homeless man and what happened, what he accepted under false pretenses will shock you. I was shocked and amazed by this story. So go check out Dave and Johnny Live. You never know what we'll say or what Johnny will say and do. Check it out right now on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/ringsidereport.net. All our shows, by the way, are up there too. Like this show's going to be up there. All the episodes of Ringside Report Radio, all the episodes of Wrestling Uncensored, What's Phantom in Japan, and Dave and Johnny Live is live every Friday afternoon around 12:30. We do the show live so you can see us. And Johnny North told a crazy story about something that happened to him this week. He also got pretty beat up in one of his wrestling matches that he had.
It's been a rough week for Johnny.
It's been a rough week for Johnny North.
Oh, man.
But he capped it off very well with a great episode of Dave and Johnny Live. And then tomorrow night we'll have Wrestling Uncensored here on TSN 690. Myself and Johnny talking pro wrestling as WWE TLC's coming up in about 3 weeks.
I'm still saying that we got to find the lady that gave the sandwich to Johnny. I think that's like a good Samaritan.
Don't ruin the story, though.
No, I'm not ruining it.
Could she be the same lady that you were with, that Johnny saw put your arm around?
Take it easy, boys.
I'm just saying.
Johnny did see you put your arm around a lady, and we discussed that as well on Dave and Johnny Live.
Johnny might have had a concussion. He doesn't always
No, because we were trying to get you to reveal it last week on the show. You didn't reveal who the lady was, what her name was, what kind of relationship you have. Was it a first date? Is she your girlfriend? Is she your wife? Is she your fiance?
Do you bring a first date to this type of wrestling show?
Who knows what AJ does on a first date, okay? What may apply to you or me does not apply to AJ D'Alessio, our main man.
That's not cool, guys. Seriously?
Well, you're a different guy. We all have different tastes.
True.
Like, many years ago, I remember bringing a date to a WWF show, WWE.
And what happened? Did you marry her?
No. But, okay. But I don't know, you know, like a local wrestling show, depends, you know.
First date I ever took my girlfriend on that we have been together for several years, right, a long time. First date we ever went on, I took her to see a movie. It was a documentary called...
Wrestling with Shadows.
No, oh. Close.
Disney.
Beyond the Mat. Oh. You know that movie?
Oh, yeah.
You know the movie I'm talking about?
Wow.
That was our first date. So she knew what she was getting into. The first night with me, she was like, oh, this guy is a wrestling fan, big time. Hey, what the hell?
And did that movie help, you know, help you get into the mood?
It's such a romantic movie.
I think we're pretty young, Fred. I don't know if we're going to...
Beyond the Mat? Are you sure it's Beyond the Mat or Under the Mat?
No, we're very young. It's a different... It was a different time. It's a different time. That's not good.
I don't know. Well, you have a kid now, so that means it went well.
Yeah, but we're talking about, this is like 2001, maybe.
It's true. Dave's...
2000.
You're still like 14?
Yeah.
Dave's been
what?
Like...
What?
Yeah.
Okay, so Chuck and Tito are fighting tomorrow night,
what?
Guys.
What happened? Now you changed it.
Yeah. Curtis Blaydes and Ganu, I want to get to that card real quick. We have some of these fights, and we got somebody on Twitter saying that they wanted our picks for the fight. Let me give this guy a shout out here. Swan Dad says, looking forward to your predictions for the upcoming UFC event. Which, like we said, 3:15 for the first prelim, 6:30 for the main card. So wake up early. It's on the Fight Network tomorrow morning. Curtis Blaydes, Francis Ngannou is the main event. Alistair Overeem's on this card, too, which is always cool. Overeem fighting this guy, Sergey Pavlovich. Overeem is the underdog in this fight. Plus 115, mm-hmm. Sergey minus 125. What do you know about Sergey Pavlovich, AJ?
He's
I don't know much.
20-year-old like beast.
He's 20 years old.
He's 20 years old. He's a beast coming out of Russia. Big fan base. He was a champion in two different organizations. This kid is power. So the
doesn't
only
have
thing,
a Wikipedia page.
Yeah,
what's
he's,
the deal?
He's young.
Is this his UFC debut?
Listen, this is his debut. The thing is that if he
is
comes
it
out,
really?
I think so. Yeah, that's his
tough
first
debut.
Fight. He's 20
right
years old,
right
man.
Away against Alistair Overeem.
Yeah, but think about it. If this guy is like what they say, he's a power puncher. He's like dangerous and whatnot. If Overeem's chin cannot,
I mean, the
take
guy
it, he's
never
going
lost.
Down.
So
he's never lost.
12-0. Oh.
Was he 12-0? I thought he was 14-0. But
yeah,
anyways.
He is 12-0, and this is his UFC debut.
You know what? It's going to be a bad night for Overeem, in my opinion.
This guy has several wins by knockout.
I'll tell you what, I'm intrigued. Okay, I'm still going to pick Overeem because, I mean, he's Overeem. He's a legend in the heavyweight division.
Not supposed to win, according to the odds. He's a slight underdog.
Yeah.
Though.
Well, I'm intrigued right now. Yeah. The odds think that this Russian guy is going to win. He's 12-0.
He's 20 years old.
Yeah, exactly.
You know,
it's always fun to see new
There's
blood.
A lot of wear and tear on
Overeem is 38 years old with a pro record of 43-17-0. So
he's still Overeem.
Yeah, of course he's still Overeem. He's a great fighter. He's a legend in the game. But he's 38 years old, and you wonder how long it's going to keep going for. How long can he stay on a top level? And he hasn't looked good in his past two fights, suffering some devastating knockout losses to tough guys in Francis Ngannou and Curtis Blaydes, but he still suffered that punishment. So I worry about Overeem going into this fight. I'm going to go with the new guy, Pavlovich.
Look, what'd you say? He was 6'3"?
I didn't say how tall he was.
Okay, yeah, so that's the thing. He's 6'3", 235 pounds, 20-year-old monster. You know what?
Why are you asking me if you know?
No, I thought you mentioned his height.
It's rhetorical, I think.
I guess.
Okay.
AJ, you're rhetorical.
The only thing...
Am I not supposed to say that?
It's all right. Listen, the only thing that I can say is going to go against Pavlovich is this, is that he gasses out as the rounds go on. He's 20 years old. He's still got to learn a little bit more.
You don't know that. You're just saying that.
Listen, man, that's what I read. What do you mean I don't know it? I'm telling you.
Fred, what
do you
think?
I mean?
Who's going to win? Overeem? Fred's got Overeem.
I'm going with Overeem.
I'm going with the new guy, Sergey, 20 years old, undefeated. He's knocking people out. He's coming in here as a favorite, slight favorite. I'm going to go with Pavlovich to win. AJ, you're going to be the tiebreaker here.
No, I'm going with Sergey, man. What do you think I've been saying?
You just said he gasses out into the late rounds. I don't know what you're saying.
He gasses out, but that's his only weak point.
So does Overeem.
Overeem's chin is going to gas out before that happens. Overeem is going to get knocked out.
His chin is going to gas out.
It's going to gas out, my friend.
How about your man, Jiangling Li, taking on David Zawada?
Yeah, I like this guy.
Who?
Jiangling.
You think he's going to win? He's a favorite, yep. minus 185, Zawada plus 170. I think he probably wins. I think a lot of these guys...
He's got no defense.
A lot of these guys in China may be set up nicely for good stylistic matchups to have a good showing in China. I know the UFC invested like a lot of money to do some sort of performance center in China. Like they opened this big training facility and they're going to try and grow the sport more and more in China to grow that market. So they're investing big time in China, so I think that they're probably going to have some Chinese fighters do well on this card. Look at Yadong Song, or Song Yadong, whatever his name is.
You like the dog.
He's a huge favorite, minus 510, Vince Morales' opponent, plus 450. So you see there, you know, a lot of these guys are expected to win. Whale Zhang taking on Jessica Aguilar, Zhang the favorite, minus 525, like a lot of heavy favorites. On the Chinese side here, and you wonder what's going on. Curtis Blaydes is a favorite, minus 240, Francis Ngannou plus 220.
It's a hard fight to pick. I'm going to pick Curtis Blaydes because he's on a good run, and Ngannou is not. I feel like Curtis Blaydes probably could fight, you know, smart and stay away from the power of Ngannou, and maybe edge a decision, or who knows, maybe he finishes Ngannou.
Yeah, but think about it. Blaydes has already fought.
Can you believe what has happened? I'm sorry, guys, but can you believe like what has happened to this guy, Francis Ngannou? Okay? In a year. Last year, okay, we're sitting here in November. We're getting close to December, right? We're coming towards the end of 2018. In January of this year, on the 20th, we were gearing up for Stipe versus Ngannou. Ngannou was undefeated, just knocked out Alistair Overeem in July of 2017, and we're thinking January, here comes Francis Ngannou.
You're right.
And then he gets tooled by Stipe Miocic, seems to lose all confidence, fights Derek Lewis, loses a terrible, terrible effort, and you start to say, well, what's going on here? And now here we are at the end of the year, when at the beginning of this calendar year, we were picking him to be the next heavyweight champion.
Everybody did.
King of the division. No one's going to stop this dude, knockout machine. Who could stop the beast, Francis Ngannou? And now we're sitting here at the end of the year thinking, oh, you know the guy that he beat a couple of years ago there, Curtis Blaydes? He finished him with a TKO stoppage in the second round. Yeah, that guy's probably going to beat him.
Yeah, but
I mean, look at what's happened to Francis Ngannou. He went from, for sure, the next champion to, yeah, he'll probably lose to the guy he already beat.
Well, he's one spectacular knockout away from being back a star, you know? That's kind of where I'm going.
Yeah, but what if it goes the other way then, right? It's one spectacular knockout that he gets from Blaydes, and it's the end of his career, probably.
Well, it does. I mean, first name that comes to mind is look at like Anthony Pettis. He was on really a big high champion, and all of a sudden he went on a losing streak. You know, so it happens. Sometimes some guys just lose it. It's the fight game. It's not easy. Every fight is tough.
A lot of it is mental as well.
It is. It's mostly mental.
Yeah, how you approach the fight.
Exactly.
Taking your spots, picking your spots. Knowing when to go and knowing when to kind of ease up, right?
But it's also about your camp, right? Who's your team? Who's supporting you? You know what? I haven't heard much about Ngannou's camp. All I can say is that Blaydes has been training with Alistair. He's with the Overeem camp. He's like he's working with guys to make him a better fighter.
Blades is training with Overeem. Didn't he just beat him in his last fight?
Yep. And Overeem started to work with him. So
Overeem, I wish I could trust the info you bring to us.
Trust me.
I always kinda,
trust me on that.
Where are you getting that from?
I've got it. I know it, man. I'm on Ringside Report, man. I'm up to date with everything.
Yeah, you're on Ringside Report, which is owned by
Dave Simon.
Dave Simon Productions. So, you know, I kind of worry about
Dave
what
Simon.
You, yeah, I worry about what
no,
you
but,
say sometimes.
No, but you know what, Dave? That's what it is. No.
He's not. Okay,
no. Why would I lie, man?
That's why Fred is here to fact check you.
Overeem says he doesn't have any ego and had no problems training.
Exactly, because it's
with
the end
Blades.
Of Alistair's
Where are they
career.
Training?
Team Elevation.
Yep.
Where's that, Denver?
I'm not sure now. Yeah.
You
know,
Dave,
you're catching
it easy
me
there.
Off guard
Team
myself.
Elevation, like, isn't that Trevor Whitman? Is that Trevor Whitman still? Or come on. Oh, no. No. That's a different team, I think, right? What's Team Elevation?
I'm not
Make
sure.
Now we're trying to
click.
Figure it out.
That's
see,
it, man. Make those fingers click.
Guard.
Oh, they were a Muscle Farm team. I don't know who they are. Where's Team Elevation? Well, they're in Denver, Colorado, that's for sure. I don't know who their, like, coaches are.
I'm not sure, but Overeem did train with him, so.
Yeah, but either or, when you think about it, it doesn't make a difference. When Ngannou fought him the first time, think about the bombs that Blades took. He got serious power punches to the chin, and it didn't do anything. He's been rocked many times coming up to this fight. Blades has a granite chin. He's solid. So, you know what? When you're looking at this fight, and you're right, Dave, from 1 year ago, we looked at a guy who was going to be the monster of the heavyweight division to right now knowing, in my opinion, he's probably going to lose this fight. Blades is just a better fighter today. And it's unfortunate for Ngannou. There was a lot of, like, you know, he looked like a good, marketable guy.
He's one of the few guys when Ngannou was on his run of knocking out everybody. Well, Blades didn't get knocked out. Yeah, he lost because he got beat up pretty badly, but...
But Ngannou got taken down as well, and that's something that no one has done that often. I'm not even sure who has, other than Blades. So, like, it just goes to show you, if you've already fought at this opponent, you're not afraid of him.
Even though he did beat you up pretty severely, though,
AJ. He can,
AJ.
But you know what? Blades is going to be knocking out Ngannou tomorrow, and that's the sad
knocking
thing about him. Knocking him out.
All right.
That's my prediction.
Fred?
I'm going Blades. Decision.
I think that's a 5-round decision.
Yeah, exactly.
That's not the main event. It is. Sorry.
That's a long fight. I don't know if, like, I think if it goes past the third round, Blades probably finishes him in the fourth or fifth.
Yeah, that makes sense for sure.
You know, like, he'll TKO him, he'll tire him out, he'll end him. Kind of like Stipe did, right? When did Stipe finish him?
But if you're Blades, you know, you don't want to put yourself in danger ever. So I think if he fights smart Blades, he's going to win a decision. But maybe he finishes Ngannou. It shows you how much, like, we all went off the Ngannou hype train. Like, last year we were all on the hype train.
Stipe didn't finish him. He beat him by decision. They went all 5 rounds. It was just a beating. Stipe won. But it was a 5-round decision. Yeah, it is strange how we've all kind of fallen off the Ngannou hype train. And you know what? We're all picking him to lose.
And
now, I'm
going to
go the other way. You know what? Screw it. I'm going the other way. I think he's going to win because, man.
Why?
First of all, he beat him already. Second of all.
Yeah, but he didn't beat him by, like, really a win, Dave. Come on.
It was a TKO.
It was a swollen eye that was stopped by the doctor.
Yeah, because he punched him so many times in the face,
so
he
couldn't
take it anymore. The doctor was like, you need to chill,
man.
No,
if he was somewhere else, maybe the doctor wouldn't have stopped it. So it could have went either way.
I'm going to go with Ngannou to win because he needs to win.
You're right.
Curtis Blades has gone on a long win streak. It is tough to win a lot of fights in a row at heavyweight, first of all. So statistically, the odds aren't in Blades' favor because he's won so many times in a row against top-level opponents. That's why the heavyweight title's been defended 3 times. 3 defenses is the record by Stipe Miocic because it's really hard to win a lot of fights in a row at heavyweight. So, not really for that reason, but mostly because Ngannou must win. If he does not win here, what happens to his career? He's in a free fall. He went from 2017, where he's on top of the world, he's destined to be the next champion, to 2018, where he loses 3 in a row, and he's looked at as, well, maybe the UFC cuts ties with him, maybe you never see him
again.
I'm
not sure of his contract situation, but if I'm the UFC, I'm still holding on to Ngannou.
Maybe, but he needs to win this fight. This is like a big stop in his career, where it's either You win this fight, you're back in the title contention, you're back in the picture of the elite heavyweights. Mm-hmm. You lose this fight, you're at the bottom of the pecking order, and you got to work your way back up again. This is a huge fight to keep him at the elite level. He loses it, he's no longer that guy, and his career takes a dip.
Yeah, but think about it. You're right, but the meal ticket doesn't end there. I mean, if you're looking at everything from like the other like promotions, like Bellator would love to have Ngannou.
But that's why
Golden
I say,
Boy Promotions right now, I think it's going to be a real threat.
If he's not crazy hungry to win this fight, he's in the wrong game.
No, I'm sure he's going to be hungry.
Of course, but I mean, the UFC, even if Ngannou loses, you don't want to let him go away because he's the type of fighter that could knock out anybody on a good night. And I'm sure Bellator, who has a nice little heavyweight division, would love to sign an Ngannou, you know? So,
and the UFC did a great job of promoting him as their next heavyweight champion earlier this year. And people knew, really not focusing on their actual heavyweight champion, Stipe Miocic, who had a great performance in that fight. Yep. They were really hyping Ngannou as the next guy. So, you know, that kind of helps Ngannou become a star. Even if he does leave the UFC, people know his name because, you know, the UFC did a hell of a job of promoting the guy.
So I think the UFC wants to be in the Ngannou business. He's still young enough also where you don't look. Remember Mark Hunt, you know, Mark Hunt at some point had a sub 500 record and all of a sudden he was like the Samoan killer that would, you know, destroy everybody.
Good point. Good point.
That's what I'm saying. Guys have turnaround performances.
Look, even if he loses and he loses well, you know, and he doesn't do that performance like he did with Lewis, which was like an embarrassment. All through, I think there was a total of, like, what, 8 punches thrown in 3 rounds? So he has to, if he loses, let's just say.
Derek Lewis got a title shot off that victory.
Yeah, what, from 5 punches?
Yeah.
No, you actually, know, it was
no, that's not true. It was the Volkov fight, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Which, that was another one altogether, you know, right?
That's
like,
the thing.
It was a miracle he won.
Ngannou likes to, I think Ngannou, you know, he likes to counterpunch. He doesn't like to attack, and if his opponent is scared and doesn't push forward, maybe it creates for a boring fight. So that's always possible, and that's where I think maybe Blades, you know, he's smart enough. He's not going to go out and brawl with Ngannou. He's going to go out and fight smartly, try not to get hurt, and that's why I could see a decision happening. I could see Blades winning by decision.
You know what? I'm looking at some facts here, and it's saying that Blades here, obviously his wrestling game is what is going to probably win him the fight. But it says here that with one more takedown, he has the record for most takedowns in UFC heavyweight history.
Really?
Yeah. One more takedown, and that's it. He's made history. Weird. So, you know what? If he does that,
it makes it a potential.
He's going to need, and I'm sure he's going to get that takedown. He's going to cement himself as like someone in UFC history, which makes for a better heavyweight champion down the road.
I think he's going to get punched in the face and it's going to hurt.
Sure, but it's not going to knock him out.
But you know
he's
what?
Already had that.
Another thing is fight against Ngannou was his first UFC fight. So I'll give him a little break on that also.
Well, I'm going to go with +220 Francis Ngannou. Can we go cash a ticket at the end of this show here, Fred? I want to stop at a Depener. All right?
Yeah. Mise au jeu.
I'm going to parlay that Francis Ngannou with Tito Ortiz, who is, unfortunately for me, the favorite, -290.
Why unfortunate?
Chuck, well, because he'd pay out more if he were the dog, and I'm going to pick him to win because he's going to beat Chuck Liddell tomorrow night. Finally, Tito Ortiz will get his revenge on the Iceman.
Yes.
Chuck Liddell coming out of retirement to fight for Oscar De La Hoya and Golden Boy Promotions tomorrow night. It's been kind of a mess. I don't know who's going to buy this thing on pay-per-view. I know.
I think a lot of people.
It was like $60, and then they dropped the price to $40. I'm hoping by fight time they dropped about 10 or 15.
No, they
15.
Did.
How much is it?
They did, Dave. They did a Black Friday today.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, so it was a Black Friday sale, and it was $20.
That's too much for one fight. Like, too much for one fight that I could probably see for free on YouTube when it's over.
No, but it's a pretty good card.
Somebody will send me a link on Twitter. People always hook me up.
It's a good card?
No, it's a decent card in a sense.
It's a decent card.
Look, listen.
What are you talking about?
It's not bad. Come on, for $20?
First of all, more importantly,
it's like two lattes at, like, Starbucks.
At Dave Simon MMA.
It's the equivalent of a local MMA fight card.
Yeah, it's not great.
Tito Ortiz against Chuck Liddell, guys.
But
come on.
That's the main event. That's it.
Yeah, but everybody wants to see that, including you guys. Look,
send me a link for it at Dave Simon MMA on Twitter. I'm not paying to see that.
When I described it to my girlfriend earlier, I said, tomorrow there's a sad MMA fight I want to watch. And she looked at me and she goes, why is it sad? I go, well, It's two guys that probably shouldn't be fighting. Definitely Chuck shouldn't be fighting anymore, but still going to watch it because they're two legends. They were champions.
Exactly.
They were champions like Chuck, 15 years ago.
Chuck is 48 years old. He hasn't fought in over 8 years. His last fight was a knockout loss in 2010 to Rich Franklin. Chuck has lost 5 of his last 6 fights.
When was he a champion? 15 years ago, at least?
He was the champion. He lost the championship to Quinton Rampage Jackson 11 years ago at UFC 71 in May of 2007. That's the last time the Iceman was the UFC light heavyweight champion. And he may not have been the greatest fighter that was a light heavyweight champion, but for my money, he is the greatest, most respectable UFC light heavyweight champion in history. Unfortunately for John Jones.
Why you say that?
I mean, come on, John Jones has screwed up so many times.
You never seen the clip of Chuck going on TV.
Dancing with the Stars. Look, but
how about Dancing with the Stars?
He was pre-USADA. He never tested positive for anything, so you give Chuck a pass. All right.
Yeah, that's testing positive for partying.
Okay, but think about what Chuck has done for the sport compared to what John Jones has done for the sport. Chuck is a pioneer of the game. Chuck is a superstar.
John Jones is the greatest light heavyweight champion.
He's the greatest light heavyweight champion. He's probably the greatest champion ever. But for me, Chuck is like the man because he really made that division and made the UFC what it was for a period in the mid-2000s.
You know what? I remember Chuck Liddell as the guy that shut up Tito Ortiz. Unfortunately, I think Tito tomorrow is going to get the last laugh and he's going to win. I'm going to pick also Tito Ortiz. But if you remember, you know, Tito was the brash, arrogant guy that went after Ken Shamrock. You know, he was talking a bunch of trash to everybody. And Chuck Liddell, who was sort of his friend, trained together, beat him once. You know, Tito didn't want to fight him. Took some time for that fight to happen. And then Chuck beat him a second time. So,
yeah, but don't forget, Chuck Liddell himself has like a pretty like... He's a pretty loudmouth himself. So, like, we're always, like, jumping on Tito Ortiz. Have you ever read his book? I'm telling you, I was looking at some of the like, quotes in his book.
That's the book.
It was crazy, man. You read it? Two women in the shower kind of thing before his fight and all this kind of stuff.
So the guy was having relations with two ladies.
Before a championship fight?
A couple hours before? He wants to stay relaxed, AJ. How do you stay relaxed?
Listen, he was saying
John
Dana
Jones
White was
partying alone.
Hey, listen,
John Jones ain't partying alone.
I'm hoping
there's one or two ladies there.
Viagra, condoms, and cocaine. Why does he need that?
Who are you talking about, Chuck or
John Jones?
Oh, sorry, I thought you were talking about Chuck because it seems like that himself. But let's be honest, if it's going to come down,
Tito in the first time they fought was 2004. Chuck knocked him out in 5 minutes 38 seconds. 38 seconds into the second round, Chuck knocked out Tito. They fought again 2 years later. 2006, Chuck knocked him out in the third round. Took a little bit longer. They were supposed to fight again later on. They both coached the Ultimate Fighter. It didn't wind up happening. That was actually Chuck's last fight. Rich Franklin was the guy that stepped in instead. So this is the third fight in the trilogy. Chuck's up 2-0. And I think this is the time for Tito. Tito has fought more recently. Tito's last fight was January 2017. He said he was going to retire. He beat Chael Sonnen.
There you go.
In the first round, submitted him for Bellator. And, you know, that was a nice win there for Tito. Tito has won 3 of his last 4 fights. And Tito, 5 years younger, has been more active. Chuck's last few outings in the octagon were sad because he was just getting knocked out by anything. Anything you threw at his face was putting the Iceman to sleep. His chin just isn't what it was. Maybe 8 years will help.
Yeah, come on.
I don't know, though. I'm going with Tito. I really don't see how Chuck...
Liddell lost everything.
I don't see how Chuck has any chance in this fight, and I think it's going to be kind of sad. Like what Fred was saying, I think it's going to be a sad fight. It's not a fight I want to see, but it's a fight that's taking place, so I have to see it. But I wouldn't... I don't want to pay money to see it. And if I were putting MMA fights together, it's not the MMA fight I would put together.
Why?
And you got to respect, I think, Dana White a little bit for not wanting any part of this Chuck Liddell money.
Yeah,
he said Chuck should retire, and he was right. Chuck should
retire. Who said
that? Dana. Well, made him stop fighting way back in 2010, and that was the right move.
Well, you know what?
What?
No, come on.
What, you think he should be fighting tomorrow night?
I mean, Dana.
Why not? He said he's going to get smashed by Tito.
He's going to get smashed, but at least give him some credit to be there. He's a former champion. He's only 48 years old. It's not like the end of the world. He's in good shape. Did you see his shape that he's in? He's in very good shape.
Yes, I did.
So what the heck? Let's see the fight, and then we'll comment about it. Like,
what?
Next week, and we'll be like,
what the
like
heck?
We said about Argentina. Like, Argentina card was going to be bad, and it turned out to be an awesome card. This is going to be an awesome fight. And Tito's going to win.
So you're saying you're always wrong?
What? What do you mean I'm always wrong?
Well, you're like, last week we said this and we were wrong.
Well, last week we did say.
This week we're saying this and we're going to be wrong.
No, like, I'm saying
I'm
the opposite.
I'm always wrong.
No, not at all, man. Listen to me. Hear me out.
Look,
this is going to be a good card.
I'm all for everybody to have the freedom to do whatever they want. So if Chuck Liddell wants to fight, good for him. And I'll watch it because, I mean, I'm an MMA fan. I'm a fan of the history, so I'll watch Chuck Liddell fight, but I don't expect much. And I'm kind of scared of the quality. Like, let's say this fight goes past one round. I wonder what type of quality of a fight we'll see.
I hope it doesn't, and I doubt it will. Remember the Ken Shamrock Hoist Gracie fight in Bellator a couple years ago? Remember when they did that and it was like really quick and kind of weird? I expect this fight to be very similar to that.
No, but they weren't really training that much. The Shamrock fight and like, come on.
What are you expecting out of this fight?
What do you think? I'm going to tell you who the real winner of this fight is.
Are you expecting a fight like we had last weekend?
No.
Which was a good card there. Santiago Ponzinibbio beating Neil Magny, knocking him out in the fourth round. Those guys went to war. It was a great main event at UFC Argentina. Nice win for Ponzinibbio. But come on, man.
I'm going to tell
Chuck
you
Chuck and
winner.
Tito aren't going to deliver that type of fight because they're not two athletes.
Fred,
in their
hear
prime.
Me out. Hear me out on this. You know who the real winner of all this is? It's not going to be Dana White because it's going to be Oscar De La Hoya with his Golden Boy promotions. This guy's the real winner. You know why? Because in the end, what I read here, because
he's underpaying everybody. No,
he's not.
Tito?
No, he's not.
Yes,
actually,
he is.
Actually,
yes,
no,
he
he's
is.
Not. He's using the boxing model. From what I'm reading here, 75% of the income from the fight and all the fighters that follow the card are going to receive the money that comes in.
You know, the numbers have been published, and some of these guys are winning $1,000, $1,200.
So what? They're not getting that in the UFC? Like on the
Nobody on the UFC is winning $1,000
no
more. No,
there's a minimum.
Yeah, there's a minimum. So, but look
like
at this.
It's like 10 grand, isn't it?
Everybody Listen. Likes to always talk about the UFC not paying their guys, including Oscar De La Hoya, who had some things to say about the UFC pay structure. But hey, other than the two main guys, Chuck and Tito, Tom Lawler's making $25,000. Other than that,
but $25,000 that he's getting to fight.
You don't think Tom Lawler was making $25,000 in the UFC?
No, for sure
he was.
But listen,
that.
At 75%,
he's making more being a pro wrestler.
Yeah, but if the pay per views come out, there's 75% take here. That's the difference. There's a 75%
for Chuck and Tito.
No, for all the fighters.
Come
for
on,
Chuck
bro.
And Tito and all the fighters.
Okay.
So, listen, wouldn't you want to be part of that in the end?
Yeah, if it were
I
true.
Mean, look, Chuck Liddell and Tito Ortiz are not going to be making anything in the UFC, but there's still a big money attraction fight. We're all going to watch it.
No, not they're not. No, they're not a big money attraction fight, and I'll tell you why. Because the building tomorrow night is nowhere near sold out. You know why it's nowhere near sold out? Because nobody wants to see this card.
What are you talking about?
Nobody wants to pay the prices that they are charging to see this one fight between two old guys that really have nothing left to give. At least when Bellator did it, they had guys like Michael Chandler and whoever the hell else they had that was still in their prime on the undercard so you could draw something into the card. This card has nothing. It's going to sell no pay-per-views, and the building's nowhere near sold out.
Right now, as of today, it's 70% sold out already.
This show's tomorrow.
It doesn't matter. It's always like that. At 70%.
Anthony,
just let me say
something. It's not 70%.
It's 70%.
Oscar De La Hoya said
that. Fake news, AJ.
No, Oscar De La Hoya said that he expects to sell 50,000 pay-per-views, which is it's nothing. Times $20, that's $1 million. You got to pay production. There's not that much extra money coming to the fighters.
Listen, man, we were talking, like, I'm telling you,
it's not easy to run an MMA show that makes money. It's
easy. But you got like Oscar De La Hoya behind it. I mean, he's
exactly.
What do you mean?
You
exactly?
see those press conferences he was doing? You think he's an eloquent fight promoter?
Look,
unbelievable. This guy's a joke. What are you talking
about?
What
do you mean
about?
He's a joke? He's Oscar
a joke.
De La Hoya.
He's a joke. Yeah, exactly. Oscar De La Hoya has become a farce.
At one time, he's a boxing promoter.
Sure.
He's a real boxing
you know,
promoter.
Is he?
Yeah, yeah,
he
yeah.
is.
So what
Canelo's
is,
with him.
Okay, well, so. this farce tomorrow night. What's the deal with that?
Look, if the
this
numbers, if the numbers,
tomorrow night is a joke. Come on.
Look,
now.
If the numbers come out. Listen, we said that about like guys that we even hear about, that Paul Logan guy that came out and all of a sudden he got like 100 like buys on YouTube. It's a
that's
we,
not this.
This is not this, but you never know. It's more accessible to everybody now. That's all I'm saying is like at $20 to see a fight.
Look,
know,
if the big part
what?
Of money
on what? How do we watch the fight? You just said it's more accessible. It's $20. How do we watch the fight, AJ? You don't even know.
No, I do. It's Fight TV. That's the new app. You just go on Fight FITE TV, and you will be able to see this fight. Yeah. It's $20 today.
I'm not paying $20 for that.
I know, but you
it's
know
not
what?
Worth it.
They're
come on. It's Chuck's retirement fund.
I've seen it before.
No, he thinks that this is just a warm-up like for like a second career here. That's what he said.
Yeah, he wants to fight Chael Sonnen.
Does he still think he could beat Jon Jones? Because Chuck used to say that.
Well, actually, what's going to happen, I think Dave said it right. I think if there's any other fight, it's going to be against Chael Sonnen because
Chael
Sonnen just
trash.
Ripped him. Just yeah. ripped him this week. It was
Chael
unbelievable.
Knows how to trash talk.
Yeah, but
I think it's kind of mean because I think Chael knows what I know is that Chuck isn't going to win. He's going to lose. It's not going to be pretty. And then Chuck will never have the chance to come back and fight Chael because maybe he'll get it through his head.
Yeah, but
he
Chael's also trashing Tito, and Tito just like put him like submitted
well,
him not
wants,
long ago.
Well, Chael wants a rematch with Tito.
Yeah,
he wants
well,
revenge.
Sure, that I don't blame him. You know, but man, it was like really bad. If you
look,
have a chance and go on his feed, you'll see all the trash talking.
You know, to end it off because we are running out of time. I am making fun of Chuck and Tito fighting, but Shogun's fighting for the UFC next weekend, so. Not all that different, I guess, right? Shogun's still going at it. He's fighting Tyson Pedro next weekend for the UFC. Junior Dos Santos is fighting Tate Tuivasa in the main event, I think.
Wow, that'll be interesting.
That's pretty sweet, right?
Yep.
That's happening.
It's about time, too.
That's, or is that next week? Or
you're sure? Because I don't see that. That's
yeah.
2 weeks from now, maybe.
December 2nd. When's that? Oh, that's not next week, is it?
Yeah, it's...
Oh, man. I want to see Junior Dos Santos. Oh, next week we got Rafael Dos Anjos against Kamaru Usman.
Well, actually, there's a card on November 30th. And
yeah, that's...
A Friday and a Sunday card.
Oh, yeah, so that is next week, Fred.
Friday.
Why are you mixing me up? So we got a lot of cards next week. We got Rafael Dos Anjos and Kamaru Usman next Friday night, so we'll be on the air while it's all going down, AJ. Get ready for that.
Listen.
It's the Ultimate Fighter 28 finale on Friday night. And then Sunday night in Australia, well, is that actually Sunday or is it going to be Friday or Saturday? Because it's a different day in Australia,
Dave,
right? So I think it's going to be probably Saturday night in Australia. That's when Junior Dos Santos takes on Tate Tuivasa and Mark Hunt fights Justin Willis. Shogun Hua against Tyson Pedro. So pretty stacked weekend for the UFC next weekend. And then tomorrow morning, like I said, they got that Beijing card at 6:30 a.m.
Dave,
yes, AJ.
I got some breaking news here. So here we go. It just popped up here. The Black Friday sale was like, it was scratched out. So Fight TV says, unfortunately, due to contractual restrictions, we are contractual restrictions, we are unable to offer the planned Black Friday discount. We apologize. So pay full price, man.
No, I pay nothing.
You know what the heck happened, man?
You know how easy it is to get these things otherwise?
No, I know, I know.
Come on. Somebody's going to send me a link. I know that. People always hook me up. They're like, oh, I paid for it here. Because a lot of these sites, you know, if you have one username, you can use it on two or three other computers, you know? So people just send me their username and I watch it.
Isn't that a crime?
No, actually. It's like Netflix.
You know that little thing at the beginning, reproduction.
No, you're allowed to have like Netflix. You're allowed
to
have
four accounts. For it. Yeah, you can have multiple accounts.
Sure.
If the site doesn't block it, that's on them. I think. Uh-oh. Fred,
that's
come
it.
On. Why are you trying to get me in trouble right
the
as
RCMP
we end
the show? Will be knocking on Dave's house tomorrow. Yeah.
Excuse
there
me,
you
sir.
Go.
Are you using somebody else's account for this thing?
I'm not sure they'll say, excuse me, sir.
Yeah,
yeah. No, they'll say...
They better say, excuse me, sir.
FBI!
Excuse me, Mr. David Simon.
Stop using my full name.
What's your middle name?
I'm not telling you.
Come on, Dave.
I'll tell you my middle name if you tell me who you took to the wrestling show last Friday night.
How do you go back to all this all the time?
Because
Jessica?
You
Who? I don't know. I'm
We're just going to throw out names. And I know
Samantha?
I know some of the names it could be, AJ. Should I start throwing out real names?
No, don't start.
What should I do?
What the hell?
I don't know what that was.
What was that? I thought you had something like pre-recorded. I was starting to sweat there for a second.
Yeah, all right. Oh, that'd be good. What are we doing for our Christmas special? We got something big cooking, AJ?
Yeah, we got like some... We got, like, some special gifts coming in.
What?
Hey, listen, man, you'll
we
see.
We got gifts for Christmas?
That's right.
All right.
And so, maybe for our fans, too.
UFC, yeah, we're definitely. There's going to be... I'm planning something. I'm planning something for Christmas, and I think I'm going to need your guys' help, but that'll be a surprise. For the holiday season, Fred, we'll see you in, like, 3 weeks, man.
Fred, man. It's going to be rough. Who are we going to bring in? Johnny North, for
yeah,
real?
Yeah, probably. Maybe...
Colin James.
Maybe our boy Dylan.
Dylan?
D'Alessandro.
Oh, yeah! The twins. That's awesome.
He texted me. He wanted to come in. Maybe
those
we'll
guys
get
are
in.
Awesome.
All right, maybe we'll get one of those guys in. All right?
Good choice.
It's Ringside Report Radio. RingsideReport.net is our website. I'll be back here for Wrestling Uncensored tomorrow night on TSN 690. Follow Fred on Twitter at FreddyMMA. Follow me at DaveSimonMMA. Follow AJ at DanEBruck. RingsideReport.net and YouTube.com/RingsideReport.net is a YouTube channel. Thanks to Jimmy for helping us tonight, right, I guess?
Well, you almost, like, trashed the poor guy.
Yeah,
but
almost, you know.
It almost, yeah.
It's all right.
It got messy there for a bit, but I really got nervous there for a bit, Dave.
I just wanted to
I didn't
you
know
nervous.
If you were joking, and then I said, no, Dave looks serious. I think he's going to hurt
joking.
This poor guy, Jimmy.
It's all right.
So
it all worked out.
If HR calls you, like, we didn't see nothing.
Yeah, you saw nothing.
No, it was
nothing.
All, like, staged. This is all
yeah,
staged.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's all part of the show, right?
It's the gimmick.
I mean, yeah, they would, yeah, choked him out almost, but, you know,
I
it was all part of the...
I did not do anything like that. You're always the
I mean,
one.
When somebody taps out, you're supposed to let go, right?
Always, man.
I know.
Courtesy.
Yeah, show respect, AJ.
Exactly.
Stop choking people unconscious.
Tap, snap, or nap.
RingsideReport.net is the website. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at DaveSimonMMA. For AJ, for Fred, I'm Dave. This has been Ringside Report Radio.